It's a beautiful day here in Horse Country, USA, and we're glad you tuned in. I'm your host, Alan Watt.
And I'm Julie Mohan.
We got a great episode for you today as we go out and meet a special young lady named Meghan, who credits horses as saving her life.
We also go to the National Ring Cow Horse Association, where they're giving free clinics to educate people on their sport.
So sit back, relax, and let's take a ride through Horse Country, USA.
Oh, okay. I used to think that all God put me here for was a joke society because he needed something to laugh at. But that horse totally changed the way I looked at that.
So I think the horses did help her, you know, because that was her escape.
Then we'll walk around a little bit and then we'll tighten a little bit more.
Okay.
All right. I see the joy she has when she's with them, and you can tell that there's, I mean, she's not worried about anything. It's just her and the horse, and that's what she loves us.
There we go.
The biggest struggle was she looks normal. So people were in denial that anything was different about her. And she was different. She couldn't read body language. She didn't get sarcasm at all. And so, of course, that it made it extremely difficult for her to make friends. She didn't have the social skills that she needed to be able to communicate with other children.
I got her.
Your horse, take her to her spot.
Come on, girl.
She was diagnosed in the third or fourth grade is when we got the diagnosis of Asperger's, which is on the autism spectrum, but that was just the beginning. Because she looked normal, people tend to be non-acceptant of it.
You want to say it?
So dear Lord, thank you for this video.
Kindergarten, it was good. Of course, they teach you to be friends with everyone, and you're to be nice to everyone. And I guess third or fourth grade, when they start splitting up and getting in their own little groups, is when she started having difficulties.
Come on, girl.
She wouldn't come out of her shell until she got home from school, and we'd spend hours hearing about the whole day and the bullying that took place, or whatever took place that day.
Hey, Meghan, running walk. Little circle, running walk.
I remember some of the times she'd cry and she'd say, "No matter how hard I try, Mom, the kids don't like me." She'd say, "The kids just don't like me." She goes, I don't know what I'm doing wrong.
Good girl.
Walk on.
There's just like so much stuff that's unbelievable that I went through, and the horse has helped me. And like I remember going to school and getting called a freak, a retard. I'd get called fat and told I was ugly. They'd even tell me I was worthless, and I've even been told to go kill myself. I thought that if I killed myself, it would all be better.
I remember one time her older brother had a really bad car accident, and he had brain trauma. And so, for some reason, we were talking about the different types of transplants. And she said, "Mom, can I get a brain transplant? Can they transplant my brain?" And of course, I'm crying and I'm like, you know, that's the one organ that they can't seem to be able to transplant.
Good boy. I think God put the horses here for his guardian angel. I had people try to fix me, and the only one that's been able to fix me was the horse. And it's just, it's one of the most rewarding experiences of my life, and it's the horse, they're magical. And I think God put them here for this reason, for they're like angels.
Hey, come on, Ebony.
She's not just a horse, she's like my therapist, but she's a lot more than that. Oh yeah. I tried other things. Other therapy worked on me. The only therapy that worked for me was the horse. And I really feel that horses could help cure my autism.
He likes to play tug of war. This is a poem that I wrote for the King Elvis. The King Elvis was the horse who helped save my life. When I looked into your eyes and you looked into my eyes, it was like you could read my mind. You would never let me fall behind. I knew you was treated bad and I knew you was sad. You have two big brown eyes full of love and a heart of gold. I will never let you go. You are the part of me that I need, the part that makes me complete. You are the true meaning between love and friendship. You take my pain away on a rainy day. You brighten my days. You make my world a better place. I will never let you fade away. You are here to stay. That was the poem.
She just talked about horses.
She talked about
so
horses
much.
All the time. She always liked horses. And she heard of this place of Wings of Hope.
The therapist is actually the one. He thought that maybe she would go there and learn to brush them and groom them and things to that nature, and then he didn't even realize that what it would do to her self-esteem. Immediately when she got up on the horse's back, she had the biggest smile on her face that I hadn't seen in a very, very long time. She was book smart on them, so it kind of came easier for her once they started training her, because she knew so much about it. So the more levels she went up, like they start out on lead rope and then walking and then trotting, and then eventually she got to canter, and then 1 year she actually got to jump. And the more she got independent, the more she competed, it was just like a whole nother child. She got her self-esteem back, she was happy. And the friend thing just seemed to, it was still there, but the horses helped her to cope with it.
Horses give me the courage, the faith, and the world, and they give me purpose and meaning in my life. And like whenever I'm on the back of a horse, all my problems I have just melt away.
What direction you're going now?
Oh, okay.
My name is Pat Leach. I've been teaching Meghan since about 2002. I've been teaching riding for about 30 years. Yeah. I can tell you the proudest I've ever been of her.
Okay.
We were last year at Chisholm Challenge, which is a show fun. That the stock show uh-huh. gives to special needs riders before the rodeo starts. And they had two of the centers wanted to do a jumping exhibition class. So I thought it would be kind of neat, and Meghan wanted to do it. Yeah. The horse's name was Chief, neat old guy. And he came up to that first jump, and it was a real jump. All he'd ever seen was barrels with a crossbow. Yeah. So he wasn't real sure about it. And Meghan, I was so proud of her, because she never got frustrated. She never got angry at him. She just kept working with it and got him over the fences and got him around the practice ring a few times. And then when it came time to do it for the real exhibition, they did an absolutely beautiful job. And basically, Meghan and that horse did it.
It's a beautiful day. Oh, yeah.
Horses have taught me
how to deal with life and how to deal with things. It's a beautiful day.
Oh, yeah. Now pull that nose. Very good turn. He's kind of a handy bugger, huh? He can swing that old front end through there pretty good.
We came up with an idea to put together a clinic featuring some of our top competitors in our association to kind of let people in the area, one, know that we're here. And ironically, we had people show up from Kansas and New Mexico, so it was a very good draw.
Very nice.
Well, we had Todd Crawford, who is our association president. He's also our all-time leading money earner in the association. He's a $2 million rider. We had Jake Telford, who is also a board member, who's a $1 million rider, and Sandy Collier, who is an icon of the cow horse sport. You know, she was the first woman to win the Snaffle Bit Futurity. She's in the Cowgirl Hall of Fame and a wealth of knowledge. Very, very experienced horseman.
Now just let him turn easy. Good.
There's nothing else like it out there right now with the people that we have involved with the clinic. I mean, where can you go and find the leaders of the Western performance horse industry doing a clinic, sharing secrets, a lifetime of knowledge for free?
Get a couple more turns in there and then we'll let him quit. That's pretty good for a first little session, you know?
And I think that's what we can assist people with now, and affiliates and regions is their expertise in organizing some of these things, because as horse trainers, we are all very willing to give our time to these kind of things, but we're not necessarily that good of organizers. And so now that we have some organization behind us, I think that will make it possible.
Executive Director Jay Winborn sees these clinics as a way to create more interest in the National Rein Cow Horse Association.
In the past, the NRCHA has oftentimes flown under the radar of the performance horse industry because we're a very small select group. And with what we do in relation to some of the other associations, ours is a triathlon, for lack of a better word. It's, you know, we do the reining, the cutting, and the fence work combined, so it's not a one-dimensional sport. And the reason we put together the clinic today was to kind of showcase that and maybe give people that were either apprehensive about trying it out or have never heard of what we've done opportunity to experience that.
And basically, we just tried to give them an overview of what Rein Cow Horse was, what kind of classes we offered, what kind of equipment we use, so that they could be somewhat prepared to come to one of our shows. And then some demonstration and also some instruction on how to do some of those things.
Todd Crawford sees the association offering more clinics just like it in the future.
Obviously, after the success of this clinic, we are certainly looking to go out regionally and produce these clinics, you know, in all our different regions, to where we can afford the same opportunity that we've given these people to experience Rein Cow Horse. It's a beautiful day.
Hi, my name is Dr. Bruce Lyle, and I'm here at the Aubrey Equine Clinic today in Horse Country, USA. And I'm really excited to bring you a three-part series, starting with this episode, on laminitis and founder. And this is one of my passions in taking care of horses. It's one of the most cussed and discussed maladies that affects our horses and mules. And actually, it affects cows and zebras and giraffes and any hooved animal. When I start out discussing this with people, I'm reminded of something my friend Dr. Jim Wallsmith said about the pie of knowledge. And there's three pieces to the pie of knowledge. One, there's the piece that we know, and we know that we know. And there's a lot of that now. Fortunately, there's been a lot of research done on laminitis and its causes and results and the like. And so we do have some information out there. The other piece of the pie of knowledge is that which we know that we don't know. there's an awful lot of that when we're dealing with laminitis also. And it's frustrating to us as veterinarians and to the farrier profession, I believe, as well as you, the owners, in that we don't have all the answers. And then there's the piece of the pie that is what we don't know that we don't know. What I hope to do today in the first part of our series is to show you that the foot is more than just that hoof that you're looking at, that there is life inside of it, that you need to be concerned with that life inside of it. I think it's important to realize that laminitis is a non-specific descript disease. It affects horses of all ages. If camera will show you here, these are films of a foal that I've been working on for about 5 months. Got severe diarrhea, foundered in all 4 feet. And I'm gonna use founder and laminitis interchangeably. When you take and look at the foot in this aspect, here's the bone, and we've taken a slice right through here, all right? And so here's the bone, here's the hoof wall, and here's the lamina. And even in this preserved specimen, I think it does a real good job of showing, here's the normal attachment, okay? This should be pretty uniform all the way around the bone. And when we get laminitis, we get defects in this attachment, okay? Now, one of the analogies that I use talking about this disease to people is, imagine the bone being a piston and the hoof capsule being a cylinder, and the lamina is the oil in between that piston and cylinder. With every step that a horse takes, there's micro movement within that hoof capsule, okay? And as long as our lamina and the meat inside the hoof capsule are functioning fully and all, we have a very sound horse. But once it's affected, okay, a lot of times the degree of soundness that we, or degree of lameness that we see is gonna be proportional to the degree of destruction of the lamina and the meat inside the foot. And so you can imagine that if every time that cylinder goes, or that piston goes down in that cylinder, we've got 20% the normal holding it up capacity of our lamina, it's gonna hurt, okay? It's kinda like I busted my thumbnail not too long ago, the whole thing came off, and well, maybe we'll post some pictures of that, because I think it's a great example of what's going on beneath the hoof capsule in a case of laminitis. What we're showing you here is a venogram, and this has been one of the most educational and inspirational diagnostic tools I've discovered in 20 some odd years of veterinary practice. The venogram shows us a circulatory pattern of the foot, and here's a normal venogram, and you can see how nice and uniform and smooth all the blood vessels are, and how the coffin bone is encapsulated within the blood vessels. And then here's a venogram of a horse with laminitis, and you can see out in the front of the foot the increase in the stretch of the blood vessels out there, and that's the activity going on that's painful, that's harmful to the horse. This disease comes in many different, I always tell people, it comes in many different fashions and flavors. And, you know, we can see things from as simple as this laminar stretch that you're looking at here to something like this picture here, where you're seeing a complete wipeout almost of all the circulation in there, and that foot has a very low chance for recovery. We can talk about the acute form and the chronic form. The acute form is a horse that's obviously rapidly affected, and it's generally considered within the first 72 hours, and that's our best opportunity to reverse what's going on. It's our best opportunity to intervene in a positive manner. On the other hand, the chronic form, we're gonna call a laminitis case chronic once we're able to see radiographic evidence. Radiographs are important because they allow us something objective to measure and monitor our progress along with the horse's pain level. There are a number of causes of laminitis. Lush green grasses have been implicated for years and years as causing founder. Getting into the feed bucket and ingesting too much feed. I treated some horses not too long ago that got into show pig feed. And yes, that's show pig feed is not good for horses and can incite laminitis. We also see, you know, the case of Barbaro that brought laminitis to the public's attention just a few years ago. He had what's called contralateral limb laminitis, and that's from the horse standing on one leg more than the other, and that foot not being able to carry the weight of the horse. Road founder is a term that we don't hear just a whole lot anymore, but I think it is part of what we see with our horses here on the hot Texas ground
retained placenta in a mare, pneumonia in a horse, severe colic. A lot of horses, post-colic surgery will be affected with laminitis. There's a number of different causes, and there's a number of different outcomes from those causes. Each one of these has a unique etiology to them. The cause of the grass founder horse is much different than the contralateral limb laminitis horse, and we'll get into a little bit of that later. But hopefully that gives you a good start to things to think about, and I hope you'll join us next week for our episode on recognizing laminitis and what to do when you do recognize it.
Thanks for joining us again for this week's Horse Country USA.
And be sure to tune in next week when we bring you a story about the miracle of modern technology that takes a horse with an only 10% chance of life to a happy, healthy horse now running the pastures.
And for more information on Horse Country USA, go to our website, horsecountryusa.net.